Hey guys, so this tutorial should go over everything we went over in class on Wednesday as well as Friday, and also a couple of other things. So this should go into more detail, an introduction into Grasshopper as well as an intro into projections in Grasshopper and how to generate a generative drawing. So like I said on Wednesday, Grasshopper is really broken down into three separate components. You have your parameters, you have your components, and then you have the connections between these. And the parameters are going to be your geometry. In the toolbar, it's on the far left side under params. And geometry is going to be where you're going to find all of the parameters that house geometry from Rhino. And if you hover over anything, it'll kind of tell you what it is. It's kind of one of the nice things about Grasshopper is that it kind of gives you hints about what it wants and what it needs in order to generate a successful script. So, your components are basically the kind of actions that Grasshopper is going to apply to the parameters. And most of these are going to coincide with Rhino. So if you can think of a command in Rhino, like loft, offset, trim, it's probably going to exist in Grasshopper as well. So you can see here, this is the loft component. It can be found under surface here in the toolbar, and then freeform. There's a number of different ways to generate a surface in Grasshopper. So most of this you should remember from Wednesday and Friday's lecture, but just in case you don't, in order to add geometry from Rhino into Grasshopper, you want to right-click a parameter and then go to set multiple or set one. You can do that with surfaces. You can set one surface, set multiple surfaces, points, breps, planes, and vectors. So a brep is going to be anything that's like a surface or polysurfaces. And surface is obviously going to be individual surfaces. So a polysurface can only be represented as a brep, but a surface can be represented as a surface or breps. Grasshopper also uses motion information as vectors. And your vector tab is here. And it's going to contain points, vectors, planes, grids, and fields. Your vector information is inherently built into every curve. So every curve has a start and end point and also has directional data about its trajectory. So you can plug curves in and they function as vectors. Surfaces kind of work with planes in a similar sense, and you can think of these the same way as your C-plane, right? So it establishes a flat surface for which we can orient objects onto. Okay, so the display information, this is kind of like a really quick look at how Grasshopper changes the way the nodes look in order to tell you how the data inside of them is working. If it's orange, it means it doesn't have any data in it. So if you hover over this little balloon, it'll say curve failed to collect data, and that's because there's nothing attached to this. If it's gray like this, it just means it has data in it and it's working properly and I can see it. So I think it's one of these points. Yeah. So you can see if I click here, it turns green in Rhino as well. And that highlights the data that exists in Rhino and how it relates to Grasshopper. And if it is shaded like this, that means it's hidden. So I can hide these by clicking them and then right-clicking and turning the preview off. And you can see that when I select them, they're no longer visible here. If I turn this back on, then they become green when I select them. So if I wanted to hide the red that I can see here on my Rhino screen, just right click preview, and it disassociates the viewport preview in Rhino. So if this is red, then it means somehow the data is not flowing correctly, or Grasshopper doesn't know exactly what you want to do with it. So you can always hover over these balloons and it'll kind of try to tell you what's happening. It says here data conversion failed from point to surface. That's because you can't generate a surface from a point, right? So because of that, Grasshopper obviously isn't going to be able to do anything with this information, and so it highlights it red. So Wednesday and Friday we went over a really basic script that essentially takes geometry and projects it onto a surface or a plane. And I'm going to go over that again really quickly. So for this script, we need three things. We need a BREP or a polysurface that we want to project here. And we need a curve that's going to give us our vector for the projection, and then we need the surface in which we're projecting onto. So you can always double-click onto the canvas of Grasshopper and search for something. So if I just type surface and then enter, it will drop in a surface parameter, and I can right-click this and assign from Rhino a parameter into Grasshopper. So I'm going to clear all of these values and then reassign them, and we'll go through the script. So I'm going to right-click this and click Set One BREP, assign that extrude, and then I'll right-click this, click Set One Curve, assign this curve as the vector, right-click this, click Set One Surface, and assign this surface. The component we're going to use is called Mesh Shadow. It can be found under Mesh and Utility. You can see here it's called Mesh Shadow. Or you could just double click onto the canvas and type mesh shadow and then enter, and it'll drop on. Let me change my display really quick to draw the full names so you guys can see exactly what's happening. Again, that's just under display, and you can change the way these nodes are represented. I prefer using the icons, it's just kind of the way I learned. But I'll turn on the display names for right now so you guys can read exactly what each one of these is doing. So it's asking for three things. It's asking for a mesh, and it will generate the mesh from a BREP, so you don't have to convert this to a mesh in Rhino. So you can just plug this in. I'm going to disconnect all of these. So I did that by right-clicking this and scrolling down to disconnect. So you can connect parameters to components by pulling out the right side of the parameter and then plugging it into the node of the component that you want to correspond to. Let's say I have multiple planes that I would like to project this onto. So I have, let's say, three. So if I wanted to project this BREP onto three of these instead of just one, I'm going to clear this. I could right-click this and click Set Multiple Surfaces. I set all three of these and click Enter. Now I have the plane for the projection as three separate surfaces, right? So, individual parameters can hold more than like one value. So if I hover over this, you can see it reads three locally defined values, three reference surfaces. If I hover over this, it's going to say one locally defined value, and it's a reference prep. So this is just the way Grasshopper is going to sort data. It's going to allow us to like do a minimal amount of work to get a lot of variation. And so if you want to kind of visualize the data or read exactly what's happening within this, you can attach a panel. So panel is under params and input, and is this little yellow notepad right here. So if I click that and drop it in, this is just kind of like a text editor. You can think of it as like a notepad. So if I plug in information from this surface, you can see that the panel is reading those three surfaces associated with this parameter. And it's important to remember that in most computer languages, Grasshopper is going to start counting at zero. And I believe the same is in Python or C sharp or a number of other object-oriented languages. So I have this now projecting onto three different planes relatively easily, and those planes are connected to the projection, so no matter where I move them, it's going to update. So it's pretty simple. It's going to output a series of curves, and I think those curves will be closed. If you hover over this right side, it says outlines three locally defined values. If I plug this in to the panel, it'll read back that there are three different polyline curves. And so if I wanted to do more with this, then I could plug it into a curve value. I could right-click this and I could bake it to get it out of Grasshopper. So again, if I select this and then right-click and hit bake, I can ask which, or I can define a specific layer, and then I can also group these things. So now I have my group number one, which is these curves. These curves are now disassociated with Grasshopper unless I, let's say, want to reassociate them. So I can right click, do set multiple curves, and now these curves are back in Grasshopper, but they're separate from the projection. So really quickly, you guys could start generating a series of drawings that are based on your object's projections in a couple studies. So if we want to get, let's say, multiple projections from different vantage points, then basically what we need are multiple light sources. So this curve is the vector in which we are projecting. And what I want to do really quick is generate a series of these that are arrayed along this curve. So I'm going to type curve and set this curve in Grasshopper. You can see it's now highlighted green. I'm going to hide this stuff so it's a little clearer. And I want to divide this curve. So if I double click on the canvas, type divide curve, we get a component called divide curve, and it's going to ask for an input curve, the number of divisions, and you can specify how the kinks work. So I'm going to input curve, and it's going to automatically give me a point count of 10. If you hover over that, you can see it says one locally defined value of 10. So I want to be able to edit that number. So what I need is a number slider. And you can get that by going into params input number slider and dragging it on. Or, and this is what I normally do, just double click on the canvas and you can type a number. So I'll type 15 and enter. And it's going to generate automatically a number slider at a value of 15. So if I plug this into the count, it's going to automatically update the division of this curve. And so now I have basically generated endpoints that I can start drawing lines from. So I want these points to connect to this curve's endpoint. So in order to get this curve's endpoint, I can go to curve and analysis and look for endpoints. Or you could just type endpoints. So you can see now this curve has a start and an end. But we want to use, okay, so it's reading that the endpoint is actually up here. So we want to use the start point. And we want to connect this point with all of these points. And we can do that. Let me bring all this down. We can do that with a line component. Oops. That's a line parameter, but we need a line component. So here's the parameter, here's the component. The component will do something with these points. The parameter just represents a line. So connect this start point to all of these endpoints, and it's returned 10 locally defined values of curves. Right? So I can now plug all of these lines into our light source, and it will change the projection for me. So you can see here, we now have a curve that we can edit in real time, and it's going to affect the way the projection works. So now, what I want to do next is project. So if this is projecting a simplified object onto a simplified surface, the next thing I want to do is to project a simplified object onto a complex object. So let me get this set up really quick. Hide all of these. So I'm going to select all of these. Right click, click preview off, and that's essentially going to hide everything from the Grasshopper canvas in the Rhino viewport. This data is still here, and this data is still flowing through, so if you have a really big script that's taking a long time to compute, hiding things isn't going to stop them from running. The only way to get things to stop working is to right click them and click enable, and it will disable whatever this component was doing. So now you can see that because I've disabled this component that was further upstream in the script, it's then stopped the data from flowing down, and so none of this is working now, right? And Grasshopper is going to represent that by changing these lines to orange, telling me that there's no data flowing through them. So I have this relatively complex object represented by this prep, and I want to project a series of spheres onto it. So our end result should be something like this, where we have a series of curves. Let me hide this. That are intersecting with the geometry that we're projecting onto. So there's not a component that's going to do this automatically. So you kind of have to get sort of crafty, and this is going to happen a lot the more and more you work in Grasshopper. There's just so much that you can do with it, and combinations of things will yield lots of different results. So what we need are a series of curves. Oops. So I'm double clicking on the canvas, typing curve, and I'm gonna assign these three curves. So these are gonna be our projection vectors, and I also need the prep to assign the poly surface to. So let me disable this. So this is the script after it's been written. I'm just essentially going to rewrite it above so that you guys can see what it's kind of going to look like when we're done with it, and then exactly how to put it together. So this is the piece of code that we're going to be working on. This is stuff for later. So this you can move things around on the canvas by selecting them and just kind of moving around. The canvas is infinitely large. If you ever get lost, you can click this button and it'll take you back to the entire document. Okay. So what I want to do is build a series of geometries that are connected to these curves and then project them onto the object. And I want them to be parametrically connected. So I want to build some spheres at points on these curves. So we need to get points on the curves first. And you can get that by going to curve analysis and then looking for point on curve. Or you can double click and type point on curve. So if I click this, it's going to return a midpoint on all of these curves. It's connected to this slider. Does everybody see that working? If you right-click this, it has absolute values that you can snap to without sliding. So what we want to do is we want to generate a sphere at each one of these points. So we're going to type sphere, click enter, and these points are going to be the base points for the sphere. So right now I think they're at a base radius of 1, which means it's 1 foot, which is really small relative to this object. So we need to make the radius larger. So I could either copy and paste this number slider and drag it down, or I can double click on the canvas and type like 25 or any number you want, and then connect this into the radius. So let's say for some reason I wanted multiple spheres on each one of these points, or on each one of these curves. I could copy and paste this to get another point on curve component, and then I could plug this into the curve, or the base of the sphere to build a new sphere. But you can see that each time I do that, it's overwriting what the previous point was. So if we hold shift and then pull, you can input multiple data flows into the same component. But if I don't hold shift, then it's going to overwrite that. So again, let's hold shift, and you can see that a little plus appears over my cursor, and I can pull that in. So now we have like several spheres that are linked to the same curve. For now, I just want the one though. Okay, so what we want to do is we want to project this sphere onto this object. We're going to use the mesh shadow component again. So we have this object that we're projecting, and then we're going to use this curve as the light source. You can see now that it's projecting these onto basically the C plane, which is the flat plane here. So you can see it's just going to automatically do that. But if I try to plug in this brep into the plane, it's not going to return a good value, and it's going to turn red. If I highlight this, it says data conversion failed from brep to plane. So that means this connection is not going to work. So I'm going to right-click that, click disconnect brep. So basically, we need to build a plane that we can then project onto. So I want to build a plane that's also connected to this curve so that they're always linked. So under the vector tab in plane, you can see this plane normal component. It says it's going to create a plane perpendicular to a vector. Click that, drag it in. It's going to ask for an origin point and a z-axis. So let's give it a point. Let's build another one of these so that it's a different point rather than the one that's in the sphere. And then we want the z-axis to be relative to the curve. So we now have a plane that's always going to be attached to these curves. So if I input this, it's now changing how the projection is oriented. So planes are really effective in determining orientations of objects in Rhino and Grasshopper. So we now have this, and we have them oriented relative to our curve, and we want to project them onto this complex geometry. The mesh shadow component isn't going to work for us, but it did give us our outlines that we want to use. So what we can do is we can extrude these curves through this object and then calculate the intersection, and that will basically give us the intersection point. So if we type extrude, we can see that it's going to ask for a base curve and then a direction. Direction's always going to be a vector. So if we plug in these outlines into the base, let me get rid of this. Can see now it's it's asking for a direction, and we can use this curve again to function as the vector for the direction of the extrusion. If you're wondering, extrusion is under surface, freeform, extrude. So you can extrude to a point, and that'll generate a cone. You can do a number of different extrusion options. So this direction is going to return a value that is only like, I think, one or two. So it's only going to extrude that far, but we really need it to extrude much further. So we need to edit the vector amplitude. And I can't remember. There it is. So under vector, vector, and amplitude, you can see there's a component that will allow us to edit the vector from this curve and the kind of length that we're computing. So under amplitude, the stock value is going to be 1, but we really need it to extrude from here all the way through this object. So it's probably going to be something like, I think 200 would work. And again, if we double-click the canvas and just type 200, it'll give us a number slider. So, oops. Can see here that we're extruding in multiple directions, but it's extruding the wrong direction. It's extruding out this way, and we want it to go back this direction. And so we need to basically flip this value. So what we can do with that is we can change this number to a negative, and that's going to be under math. Or you can just type negative. So you can see it's under the math tab, under operators. And this is going to return any positive value and flip it into a negative. So if we wanted to verify that, we could use the panel. Plug the panel in, and it's going to say this is obviously 200.0. If we plug it in here, it's negative 200.0. So you can see what the data is doing. So now these are starting to move through the object. Not quite as much as we want, so we can increase this number. So for whatever reason, it's giving me three kind of points. Not exactly sure why it's extruded in three directions. So let me pause the video real quick and I'll see if I can check that out. Okay, so this is maybe going to be a little bit difficult to explain, but we'll go over really quickly why this is extruding in three directions. And if you don't understand it at this moment, that's okay. But note that you can kind of come back to this video and re-reference why this is happening, because you might have experiences in Grasshopper where things are doing something similar to this. So the reason this vector is interpreting three vectors for each line is because we're using each line and we're funneling the data from each line into the vector. And instead of it just going 1, 2, 3 for each corresponding line and extruding this geometry 1, 2, and 3 times relative to the curve, it's extruding each line, or it's extruding the curve 3 times per each curve. So you can see they're the same extrusion. That's because this extrusion is the same as this one. This is the same as this one and this one. This one is the same as this one. And so basically what it's doing is it's applying the vector point of each one of these curves at each point, right? So we only want it to extrude to the direction relative to the curve that the point is on. And so that's going to be kind of difficult to explain at this point how to control that. But basically, all you need to know is that you need to change the way the data is being interpreted. So it's extruding, like you can see here, three different locations at each point. So we only want it to extrude at one location for each point. So it's going 1, 2, 3 at each point, and we only want it to extrude once. So if I right-click this, you can see there's these series of options that you can tack on to the way the data is being represented. If you reverse it, then it's going to flip how this data is being interpreted. So you can see these numbers are just changing from top to bottom because I'm reversing the data order. But that's not really what I want to do here. I just want to separate each one of these so it's its own value. So we can do that by typing graphed or clicking graphed, and it's going to graft the data into their own branches, basically, is how this was working. So if you notice, our dashed line or our connections has shifted from a solid line to a dashed line. And what this is doing is it's signaling for us that the data is starting to branch, and that means it's going from a single list of information that can be traced along a single line. So this has one effective branch that has three values on it. And then we're getting information with more branches, and it's being represented by these dashed lines. So the data is in this set is now being represented by three different branches that you can see here. And each one of these branches has one item associated with it. And Grasshopper is telling us that this is becoming, the data is becoming more complex through this dashed line. So I think the easiest way to visualize how this is working is with a panel. You can see if I don't graph it, it doesn't turn into a branch because it's all on one list. But if I graph it, it's going to separate that list into three specific branches, and this is the point where it forks. So if you want to visualize that, you can use this component, which is called Param Viewer, and it is specifically for viewing how data is structured. So if we plug this information in, it's going to tell us this data has three branches, and those are associated here. This is getting a little advanced a little quickly, but I just wanted to explain as simply as I could right now how this is working and why this is happening. If you right-click this and click Draw Tree, it's going to give you a visualization of how this information is being processed. So if we turn off graphed, you can see it's only going to have one line, and that represents these three vectors, right? So this one line is being applied to this point, and this point, which is why it's branching out, where it's extruding in three different directions. We don't want that. So by grafting, which subdivides each item into its own branch, we now have three branches that are organized under these three curves. Again, this is a little advanced for right now, but keep in mind that data is organized in branches, and if you want to visualize that data, you can use the parameter viewer. So as you kind of learn more about Grasshopper, if you want to learn more information about that, you can read in the primer that we uploaded to Blackboard more information about data branches and trees. Okay, so we now have this extrusion that's passing through the object, and we want to calculate this intersection. So I'm going to delete this. So we basically want the curves from the intersection of this with this. There's a couple different ways of doing that, but most of those ways are going to be under the intersection tab. You can see here, I think what we want to use is brep on brep intersection because we have two polysurfaces, or two sets of polysurfaces, I should say. We have four polysurfaces organized in two sets. So we have these three extrusions, we have this one brep. So I'm going to plug this in as A and these in as B. And it's going to return a series of curves. So I'm going to hide everything else so you guys can see it a little more clearly. That we're now projecting these spheres onto this object. Now, if yours returned, if yours isn't returning something here, then it could be because these extrusions aren't closed. And in order to get them to be closed, you can double-click and type cap. And you can use the cap hole component to close these breps and then ensure that you get a proper intersection between this geometry. And if anybody needs any clarification to anything that we're going over here, feel free to email me and tell me at what point in the video, you would like additional information on. So, we now have these curves, that we're projecting onto our object, which is great. It's a relatively complex script. We can edit these points to change the way the projection works. There we go. So you can see that each time I drag one of these points, it has to recalculate this entire intersection. It's kind of slowing my computer down. So if you're doing something like this and you want to stall the script until you've edited what you want to edit and then rerun it, you can right-click anywhere on the canvas and type, or just click Lock Solver. So you can see this little lock came up, and that signifies that nothing is going to happen over here until I unlock it. So now I'm free to edit everything however I want. And then we can right click again and unclick Lock Solver, and it should run through everything. So let's say instead of, you could just bake these lines and then do a series of make 2Ds to get the information you want. But let's say you want to render this intersection. So you need these to be surfaces along the object, not just curves. So in order to get these intersections, we could go back to the intersection tab, and under shape, we'll look for solid intersection. And this is going to give us the solid, whereas this just gave us the curve. So that's again under intersection shape. And we could just double click and type solid intersection, and you can see that solid intersection is going to come up. Sometimes Grasshopper tries to interpret what you're doing and give you hints about what it thinks might work with the components you're using, and those hints are down here. If you hover over them, they should kind of tell you what they are. So like if I click this one, that's a project along component, and that'll project geometry onto a plane with a direction. So that's just kind of Grasshopper's way of like hinting at other stuff that it thinks might be helpful for what you're doing. So I want to connect these two breps again and return the intersection as a solid. Oops. So I have everything turned off right now. Or not turned off, but it's hidden. So that's this icon up here. You can see it's highlighted, and it's not letting Grasshopper draw anything in Rhino. I can change that to wireframe by clicking this, or I can change that to solid by clicking this. I'm usually working in solid. You can also use this one, which this one's kind of interesting. It will keep everything turned off except what you're clicking. So anything you click that's green, it will show. So if we bake these by right-clicking, typing or clicking bake, and clicking OK, you can see that we now have the solid version of these curves that we wanted, and we could then articulate how these are intersecting with this object by changing, I don't know, the render material, and then re-rendering this to place behind the drawing. So that's kind of it for solid projections. I want to go over just for a few more minutes how to generate a kind of generative drawing that is connected to a series of curves that produces some intense results. So this is the script we're going to be going over, and it's relatively complex. Let me clean it up really quick. But our end result is going to be pretty interesting. Sorry. So just get this set up. So what this script is going to do is it's going to take a series of curves. So the only thing I'm the only thing that I'm doing in Rhino is building a couple curves, and then I'm generating this drawing that's kind of like fuzzy interpolation of these four curves. So the way we're going to do this is we're going to take four curves and we're going to loft between these curves, and we're going to subdivide a surface, and then we're going to select points from that subdivision, and we're going to start drawing these tangent curves out from those points. And that extrusion of these lines is going to be relative to the curvature of this surface. And then we're going to apply a gradient to represent them. Okay. So let just pull these off. You can take four curves. I'm gonna turn all this stuff off so that we're only looking at these. So we want these four curves to generate a loft for us. Me clear these values. And disconnect this. So I'm going to assign a curve parameter to each one of these curves. And then, oops. And then I'm going to plug all of them into the curve portion of the loft component. And again, in order to plug all of these in, you have to hold shift, otherwise it'll just replace the one that you're dragging. You can see as we plug them in, it's kind of building out that loft. So if some of you are getting something where the surface is flipping, that's because where you assigned these curves, when you clicked on them to set them here in Grasshopper, Grasshopper is going to associate that point that you clicked with, and it's going to kind of move along that loft line. So some of you might have something that looks kind of like this. So if I click over here now, it's probably going to flip the surface that the loft is generating. Nope, that one worked. And that worked too. Great. Okay, so just keep in mind if any of you have your surfaces flipped, keep in mind where you're clicking, because Grasshopper is going to remember where you assigned the point, or where you assigned the curve in Rhino. So we now have our lofted surface, and basically what we want to do is we want to subdivide this surface and generate a series of points. So we can type divide surface, and it's going to bring up this component which can be found under surface, and we can plug our loft into that, and it's going to populate the loft with a series of points. We want to change this U and V count to increase or decrease this number. So if I double click on the canvas, type a number. We can then parametrically control how the surface is being subdivided. So we then want to take these points and, or these parameters rather, and we want to start generating tangent lines. Let me see how we did this earlier. So we want to get a series of curves from each one of these. So under spline, we're going to interpolate each one of these points. So you can now see that we have a series of curves that are arrayed along the surface. again, our in data is now branching because it's being represented by this dashed line. And that's because these points are organized relative to the U and the V direction. So if we want to visualize that, we can click Param Viewer, plug this in, and it says there's data with 27 branches. So you can see that corresponds directly to this number. And each one of these points is being put into a branch that is relative to this subdivision. So if I change this number in real time, the number of branches is going to also change. If I want to see how the tree is viewed, and this is kind of how I most simply can understand how data structures work, you can right-click this and then click Draw Tree. And then in real time, this will also increase. So you can kind of start to understand how Grasshopper is remembering this data. So when I move this, it's not going to change the data tree because it's just generating a tree along each one of these paths. If I flipped this surface, it would probably generate a tree along each one of these, and then this would be the driver for the number of trees. Let me try that actually. This one is still the driver. Okay, sorry. So we have now these vertices, or these curves, that are being generated from these points along a loft that are generated from these four curves. So the next thing we want to do is we're going to evaluate the curvature of each one of these curves, and then we're going to generate tangent points that we're then going to extrude lines off of in a specific vector. So let's see, we're going to need to divide this curve and then also evaluate this curve. Sorry. So I want to divide each one of these curves. And I think for now, I'm just going to assign one number slider to each one of these. So now these divisions are linked just to only one. So we also want to evaluate the curvature at a specific moment so that we can then generate a kind of vector to extrude out on. So you can do that with this curvature component, and I think that's going to be under curve analysis and curvature. So that's right here. So if we plug this in, and then it's asking for a parameter. So it basically wants the parameter from this subdivision so that it can then generate the curves of this surface at this point. So this is already kind of generating something that is a little crazy and not super helpful for right now, but we need the data of this each one of these curves to generate these tangents. Let me turn this down a little bit so it's a little easier to read. I'm going to actually turn this off. So we then want to build a series of lines that have directionality and a vector that we're going to pull off of these points. So there are many ways to build lines, there are many ways to build surfaces. This one is going to help us the most because we want to specify a start point and the direction and the length of it, because those are the values that we're going to be editing. So we can pull our points onto these start points, and then tangents into the direction, so that we're extruding these curves out relative to the tangent of this point on this surface. I'm again just going to pull point and tangent, and then we're going to assign a specific link for that tangent. Can see now this is going to start drawing a curve out that appears to start giving our surface a kind of fuzzy demeanor. So basically, we're just taking a surface, we're dividing that surface into a series of points, and generating a series of curves from those points. And then we're subdividing that curve and making tangent lines off of points along that curve. And we want to do the same thing for this. So I can copy and paste. And I want to use a different number for this. So I'm going to disconnect that, build in a new number slider. So now this tangent line is going to be moving out relative to this. Me kind of clean this up really quick. Okay, so if you'll notice that some of these are generating a positive and a negative kind of line, so sometimes they're going above the surface, sometimes they're going below. And we can look at the values in this curvature, and we can see that it's reading a few negative values, but we don't want that. We want that kind of absolute positive value. Again, this is just kind of the panel, which is like the notepad, and it kind of allows you to visualize data. So I just want all of these numbers to be positive, so that each one of these curves is oriented in the same direction and not flipped. So we need to get the absolute value of that. And that's going to be under math operators. And we can plug this in, and it's going to basically reorient all of these vectors for us. So you can see the comparison between the value of the data before we pushed it through this absolute parameter, or this absolute component. So now if I plug this into direction, they should all orient in the same way. And again, I can change the way that's working with this number slider. So now we have these three kind of curves that are being pulled off of the surface. And right now, they're not quite as dense as I would like them to be. You can kind of start to get moments of density and overlaps, but I think we want to increase the subdivision of the surface. So if I come back here, I can just increase this line. Increase these numbers, and then oh, I forgot to oh, yeah, and then increase these numbers, and we can really start to get a pretty dynamic drawing very quickly that evaluates the curvature of the surface. this down a little bit. I think I want these to be longer than the others. Maybe that's too much. So, kind of produces a quick field condition based on the surface. So we now have this set of curves, this set of curves, and this set of curves. And we want these to kind of be represented by a gradient, and we want that gradient to be relative to the number of these lines. So if we plug this in, we can see that we have a whole lot of lines that are all on different branching data sets, but we want them to be all in the same list. So if we move this all onto this component, we're kind of entwining the data, but it's not flattening the data into one list. And in order to do that, we can right-click this, click Flatten, and now you can see that we've shifted the way that this data tree works, and this line is no longer dashed, it's now solid, representing a single branch. So let's visualize that really quick. So I have one that is flattened, and then one that is not. Again, this is the param viewer, and this is just to visualize the way data is flowing. So this is the one that's been flattened by right-clicking this and clicking Flatten, and it's just flattening all the information into one branch. And then this is the one that's not been flattened. So if we draw this tree by right-clicking and clicking Draw Tree, you can see how we've edited the complexity. And we want to do this because we basically want Grasshopper to count these one at a time and then assign a color to it relative to a gradient. So there's a whole list of different ways to visualize data or parameters in Grasshopper. You can use a whole number of these components that will generate color. I use the gradient a lot. So what it's going to ask for is a lower limit, an upper limit, and then this, which is parameter, which is like the kind of number of steps that it steps along that limit. So we want our lower limit to be 0, which it already is by stock. And we want our upper limit to be the number of lines that are in this list. So we have 1,260 lines, because you have to keep into account number 0. We have 1,260 line-like curves. So we could type 1,260 into a number slider and give that to our upper limit, or we can pull this number from this list. And you can do that by typing list length. So this is going to be under this set tab. And this set tab is really where you start to get all of your data control tools. So this is how you edit trees and the way data is being organized. This stuff is a little advanced for right now, but basically this is a list, and all of your list tools for grabbing one of these or editing how this order is here. So if we wanted to just grab, let's say, curve number 1231 from this entire list, it would be super difficult to figure out or like how to do that in Rhino by like baking out and then selecting one and then plugging it back in through here. But if we wanted to, we could do list item and then plug this listed to the list and index that we want number 1230, and it will return that single curve, which is right here. So curve number 1230 is right here. And this isn't helpful for this script, but if you have a long list and you want to select a single item from that list, list item is how you do it. So you can see this is how Grasshopper is counting these objects. And basically, we want it to count these objects and then assign a color to it. So you can see it's starting here, and it looks like it's counting them 1, 2, 3, 4, all the way up to 1260, which should be on the opposite end. Somewhere over here. I can't see it. Oops. 1259, excuse me. Yeah. So, Grasshopper is effectively counting them starting at 0 here and then ending with number 1259 here. So, we want our upper limit to be 1260. So we want it to be the length of this list. So we're going to plug this list into this list length component. Excuse me. And it's going to return that number. So if I plug this into the upper limit, it will now calculate along this gradient numbers 1 through 12. 60. So, let's see. If we plug this gradient tool, well, what we need to do is we need to merge this with this. So we can do that by doing color swatch. No, excuse me. Shader, that's what it was. So this is going to be located under this display tab and preview. Yours might look a little different. I have a few plugins that have been added. But this is going to allow us to generate a preview with this color. And Grasshopper reads colors as shaders. So we want the geometry to be these curves. And then we want the shader to be this gradient. So you can see that we're returning P is not generating data. So P is how it's basically counting along this upper and lower limit. So what we need is we need to establish a domain. I think. Well, we need a range of items that is, excuse me, we need a list of items, or a list that is the same as this list length here, so that it can count 1 through 1260. So we're going to do that by generating a range, and all this is going to do is it's just going to generate a list of numbers between something and something. So I'm going to disconnect these. If I wanted to, I could generate a custom domain, and I could set this to 1260, and then say I want it to step every one time. You could also change this and make it step every 10, so that then it would change the value on this curvature every 10 curves, but we want it to step every single curve. So if we plug this range in, it'll generate a list of these curves. So it's then corresponding with the number of the curve. So value, let's say curve number 1100 now gets value 1100 along this gradient applied to it. And we did that by generating a list of, or excuse me, a range that is connected directly to this list. And that range generates a list of values relative to the domain of the length of the list, and then it steps up that list value one every step. So we could change this and have it step up the list every 10 if we wanted to, or every 100, and then the gradient of these curves would not be as smooth. So the gradient tool also, you can use more colors than just like red and pink. You can right click this and you can load other presets. You can just do like a black and white. You can also pull these numbers or these little sliders and it will automatically update. Or you can set custom colors by clicking into here. Right clicking these points. And then editing things along the spectrum. I usually just kind of use the custom presets. So we now have a drawing that is generating a series of overlapping field conditions that are relative to four points, or four curves. And these curves could be edited, and the drawing will also in real time edit as well. I think it produces some pretty interesting results really quickly, and you could apply this to any four curves. So this is a kind of like really quick basic introduction to generating a complex generative drawing like this. It's something that like I think is pretty helpful when you're trying to just, sorry about that, the recorder keeps cutting out on me. But I think this is helpful for understanding how just a couple of inputs can generate through data streams some very complex outputs. So again, like I said earlier, you can feel free to email me if you guys have questions about how the specifics of this works. But I think this is a pretty good introduction on projecting geometry and generating and building a generative drawing. So again, email me if you have any questions. All right, thanks.